Okay. So first of all, let me introduce myself. This is a brief introduction from my side. I've done BTech honors in computer science, and I'm having more than over 7 years of corporate experience in multiple domains. And that includes all kind of hospitality domain, retail chains, banking and finance. I've specifically worked on, cruise line industries also. Along with that, I have also worked on e-commerce platform. So like these all are the some of the domains which I have actually followed and worked upon. And along with that, I have been associated with many MNCs throughout my tenure. And also, I've been working on almost all kind of projects, wherein the duration was from 15 days till 1.5 years. So like, you can just scale it on a scale of a small or medium or large. So this is all from my end. So let me also introduce about Minds Map. So as you people will be associated with Minds Map for the entire BA training course, so let me just brief you about like how and what exactly will be the roadmap which we'll be following while we are just covering all the topics and we are going through the session. So basically, let me go on to this link first. So I guess many of you have already visited this page. So this is where we have a brief of all the content of like what we will be covering throughout the session. Okay. So you have all the questionnaires here. Just a second. I mean, you have the complete roadmap of the entire session, what all we will be covering and, how that will be benefiting you all. And by the end of the session, what is the, kind of expectation that, you will be like able to clear all the BA interview specifically, and it will be also helpful for you guys for clearing all the certifications related to the BA related to BA course. Okay. And then you have access to complete knowledge base of Minds Map, as I'll show you. It's not just whatever PPTs or whatever videos I will be sharing with you. You will be having access to all the articles, all the blogs, all the training materials which have been associated with other trainers also. So the complete knowledge base access will be provided to you. So let's say, we'll be entering this area. And whatever PPTs, whatever presentations I'll be giving you and the videos of the complete session, which will be part of. So that all will be also uploaded and you will be having access to all those videos and all those presentations so that you guys can just go through go through with all the content so that, you can have a great revision at your end for that. So let's say, as we are registered to BA course. So I'll just show you. So this is, you know, these all are the study material related to the BA course, which few of them are the ones which I've uploaded. This contains the PPTs for the entire session. Okay, and you can see that, you know, you will find the presentations from multiple trainers, or, you know, like say you have, just a second. Okay, so you have the access to the entire content. So whatever is being uploaded onto the MindsMap site, irrespective of who has uploaded it, you are actually having access to entire thing. And along with this, we'll be helping you out for your resume preparation and mock interviews. So I'll show you this, but we'll be covering in our later slides the resume preparation part. So let me just show you a gist of like what exactly. So this is, you know, how we'll be having you helping you out for preparing the resumes. And I'll be covering like the complete resume templates and the latest, basically the latest templates on how to write a resume and how to make it so effective that, you know, it's kind of appealing for all the recruiters over there. So we'll be just covering that almost, you know, once we are done with the entire session of BA. So we'll be covering the resume preparation also. So I can see there are many people who have joined now. So I would like to have an introduction from you all before we start the session. Aparna, yes, we are done with that. I mean, Girja Sharma is also there, as I can see. And Aparna, can you just also, I mean, can you just let me, can you just introduce yourself, like what all you have been doing, and, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So hi, I'm Aparna. Yeah, and I have my Bachelor of Engineering degree in Electronics and Communication. And I have worked like a couple of years as a software tester QA in India with Intergraph and GE. And then we moved to US because of my husband's work. And then I was like on a visa, which didn't let me work. And now I want to start my career again. So that's why I landed up here.
Okay, that's great to hear that you are from an IT background. So things will be much easier for you, I mean, specifically because we will be taking a BA training for the, you know, IT industry specifically. Also, I mean, by saying this, it doesn't mean that, you know, all the people who are not from IT background, it, you know, they will be having some kind of trouble in getting the things. But yes, definitely, I mean, it's definitely an add-on if you're in, if you're from IT. So that's great to hear from you, Aparna, and nice to see you here.
Yeah, thank you so much, Mika.
thank you. And next I can see Girja Sharma. hi, Girja. Hello, Girja. Are you there? Hello. You're not audible. Okay, meanwhile, Amarnath.
Hi everyone. Hello.
You're audible.
Hi everyone. My name is Amarnath. I've done my master's in economics and statistics. I have 7 years of experience in investment banking. Currently, I'm working as a currency trader and a future trader.
Okay, so great to see you here, Amarnath.
Yeah, thanks.
So, I mean, any specific thing which motivated you for being a BA? I mean.
See, earlier, when I was working in India and Europe, usually I'm into finance background and economics. When I came to US, I thought there's a lot of opportunities which people who have domain knowledge, and especially in finance, that helps you on getting the BA job easy. So that I just ended up here.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, that's kind of true because banking and finance, again, it's a really a plus point if you're from that background and having such a vast experience. So definitely, I mean, so that's really great. Yes.
Thanks.
Yeah. Narjeez Hassan.
Hi, my name is Narjeez. How are you?
Yeah, we are doing good. So how's you?
A little bit about myself, but before I wanted to say, before I chat about myself, you have a really, really amazing resume and information about you, your experience and everything. I was really impressed. So I'm really happy that I'm part of this, first of all. About myself, I've done master's in human resources. So I'm from non-IT background. I worked with Wells Fargo Bank for almost like 5 years. So I do have finance experience, domain experience, but again, it's not non-IT. And BA, my couple of friends and family, they are in the IT industry, and they kind of like motivated me to be in here and also wanted to try a different field and see how I'll do and fit in this. So that's why I'm here.
Okay, Narji. So, I mean, it's really great to see you, and we really commit that, you know, we will be up to your expectations. So, all the best.
Thank you.
Yeah. So, I can see there's one more caller, 02. Girja has already left. I guess there would be some problem with. So who's this caller to here? I mean, I would like to request that you know, you can just log in with a specific name of yours. I mean, caller one, caller two is kind of. Hello. Manu was joined as caller 2. Not sure. Okay, so maybe someone has joined from phone. Okay, so we shall start now. I'm having some throat problem. Is my voice clear? And it is, you know, are you all able to get me?
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So first of all, before we actually jump into the complete BA theory, so let me tell you, like, you know, what exactly is a business process, okay? before we enter into any domain or, you know, any technology, or we are associated with any company, first and foremost thing is to understand the entire process, like how they actually work, because there are, you know, several kind of industries, you know, as Amarnath said that he has worked in finance and domain. So they have a complete, you know, different style of working. They have completely different methodologies. They have a completely different defined process, how they are working. If you are entering into a hospitality domain, hotel industries, cruise line industry, so they will have a complete different, you know, process and the kind of experience people they are who all are associated with in that domain. So you will have a complete different flavors, you know, in all the different domains when you're working. So before you're entering into a specific domain, so that is the basic thing for a BA. And in fact, I should not say that it is just a BA. It's, you know, any kind of profile you are entering with. So I mean, it's really important that you should have a complete, not complete, but you should have a brief idea of like how that particular company is actually working, and on, you know, what kind of processes they are following, and how, if it's a manufacturing company, so what all they have been manufacturing so far, and, you know, anything related to the complete flavor or the complete process of that particular institution. So business process is one important aspect for, you know, for specifically for a business analyst to enter into a particular domain. Okay, so I would like to get it from you guys, like, what exactly do you understand by a business process? So anyone can, you know, just if can explain like what exactly comes up in their mind when they see this name as a process in a business.
Is a flow of any business from starting to end.
Yes, I mean that's absolutely correct. So yes, I mean it's a flow from the very, you know, entering point till, either if it's a product, then it's a product outcome, or, you know, and the input and output, it also depend on which domain you are entering. Right, because say if in any specific organization, so you have, you know, if it's a cruise line industry, so the input for them will be the customers basically, and the output will be, you know, kind of revenue generation and, you know, various reports they'll be looking at. Along with that, I mean there are certain kind of industries like a manufacturing industry. So for them, the input is a kind of raw material, and the final product will be there as the final output. So, you know, this is how we can differentiate between different domains. Okay. So again, a business process is, again, you know, nothing but it is a set of related tasks that is performed to accomplish a specific goal, a specific organizational goal. So, and you know, these goals are really subjective. So I mean, but yes, there are some common goals throughout various industries. One is to increase the profitability of the company itself. So I mean, there are subjective goals as well as there are some common goals with respect to all the industries which are currently there across globe. Okay. Or, you know, if you want to just refine that particular statement of what Amarnath has already said, that it's a series of logically structured activities that produce a specific service or product for the customers. If it's an e-commerce industry, so, you know, again, you have the products as an input, and all right, if it's, you know, if it's also a manufacturing, then a raw material will be there as an input, some web portal or, you know, some mobile application. So those will be the, you know, outcome of that particular e-commerce industry wherein they are actually selling out the goods. Okay. So this is just a brief of what a process is. Process is just, you know, encapsulated inside the business. So there is an input, some kind of process is running on that input, and then a specific output is generated wherein, you know, the entire profitability is counted upon for the business. So various kind of reports are also generated wherein, you know, the stakeholders or all the business users, they are looking at those reports, and those are kind of, you know, just deciding upon the trends and how to proceed with, I mean, based on that reports. So all the statistics are also calculated by the business at the end of the all the processes, basically. Okay. And now, why the process is required? Aparna, what are your thoughts on that? Why a business should have a standard set of process to run upon?
To achieve the same kind of result every time.
Correct. I mean, not to deviate from the standard thing, right?
Yeah,
that's one thing. Absolutely right.
Yeah.
So, anything else? Okay.
So it may be easy to maintain. I mean, if there's a specific process, then achieving the result will always be the same. I mean, that's what I said before. So, yeah,
that's absolutely true, and you know, it's 100% correct. So not deviating from any standard practices which the business is following, to, and that will also help achieving the or retaining the quality of whatever they are delivering. So if they have a standard process, yeah, so definitely that quality is sustainable for them. So definitely, I mean, it's a really valid point. Anything, Narjis, you want to add on?
She's already mentioned that part, but to just to avoid errors and just to like kind of follow the steps, so there's no mistakes or errors from any end, and try to achieve the desired product.
Correct.
Probably just.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Thank you so much. Okay. So I mean, this is really the main aspect, I should say, that a business should have a defined process. So there are certain points which I came up with you know, for the business processes, like to remain successful and competitive. Obviously, I mean, because now it's a world of competition, and if you are lacking on anything, because as you said, that if there is no process, then probably, you know, or, you know, kind of eventually or gradually the quality of the things which the business has actually, you know, has aimed to deliver to the customer, they might get degraded with time. Okay, because there would be many loopholes in the system if the process is not there. So that, and, you know, in this competition, we cannot afford to do that. I mean, just compromising onto a quality is really not acceptable from customers also, because nowadays the customers are really vigilant. I mean, they are so much of, you know, they have so much of places to actually inquire, they have so much of places to actually compare the things, compare the goods. So that is why, to remain competitive, to remain successful, a process is definitely required in the business. Okay. Again, to progress in a structured manner to, in order to avoid any conflicts, as Narjis and Aparna already stated, that will result in a satisfied customer. It will result in, and yes, I mean, a process is really required not only for the products or not only for the output which the business is generating. I mean, a process is really required for the workers also who are working inside that organization, all the employees, because they are kind of, you know, the key factors for any organization. Okay. So definitely for the employees and the workers, a structured way of structured work culture, you know, it is kind of really mandate or really necessary. I mean, from you all, I mean, who all will be happy to work in an organization which have no rules, no disciplines? You're not getting a salary on every, you know, last day of month, and it is just getting delayed. As soon as you reach office, I mean, there are no specific timings. Your team is not reaching there. You have no operational teams for operating. I mean, as you said, Narjeez, you are an HR. So definitely you can relate more to the processes side of a company for, you know, employees. So if at all, I mean, there are no processes introduced by you, so do you really think that employees will be motivated to work upon if there are no appraisal cycles for them? So everything, you know, not only for the external factors, also for the internal factors, a business should be abided by the processes. Okay, so that will be helpful in increasing the revenues. It will lower down the production cost, because if you have a defined and structured manner of creating the goods or creating the products, so definitely the production cost will reduce. Efficiently, the work is distributed and the manpower is utilized. Significant uses of all the resources, be it be the employees or the machineries or anything. I mean, we can use them significantly if we have a process defined for that. So anything anyone else would like to add on this, or shall we proceed? Okay. Now, why the IT actually came into picture? So we have a business, we have a process defined in the business, we know the entire process of the business, I mean, from starting till the end. Now I'm starting up a business, and I have defined all the processes. I have bought all the machineries and everything. Okay, but now what? I mean, because, you know, like, say if I'm a manufacturing unit, okay, so do you really think that while manufacturing we can just proceed with all the manual efforts? I mean, just taking a good and manually, like say if I'm into a jewelry industry, so, you know, just taking all the metals and stones and manually creating all the designs and then delivering it to customers. So how many designs I can create in a single day, irrespective of, like, if I'm taking lakhs of labels, then also, I mean, the product, the quantity of the product which is created at the end, it is far less with whatever the expectation is from the expectation is for the outside world, right? So definitely the need of an automation, it is always there in business to automate certain tasks, certain repetitive tasks. So for example, if we are working in a cruise line industry, so if all the check-in and check-out processes, if they would have been manual till date, or a railway booking system, okay, so if, you know, buying tickets is always just going on to the counter and getting the tickets, so how painful that is for the customers also, right? So once that online online reservation booking system has been started, so it is the ease for the customers also. Also, it is helpful for that business, for the cruise line industry or for the railway department, that, you know, they literally had a boom once that online ticketing was introduced. So they literally had a boom of, you know, getting the tickets reserved, sitting at home. So there are multiple things, they can earn with while putting up an e-commerce platform, by putting up the online reservation. But apart from that, from their basic core, functionalities, or I should say the core thing of that particular railway system, that is, you know, getting the reservations on time for the customers. So that has been it's so easy, and that has been increased so much by actually providing this online facility to the user. So what they have done is they have just automated the thing, which was manually done, I mean, prior to that. So that is how the automation in business really works. So for that, I mean, once the business is automated, so it's really time and cost effective. It eliminates all the errors which, you know, which manually can happen, right? There are efficient and accurate solutions and products, because now you have a certain system which is actually producing the goods for you, which is actually working for you. So that is why you will always have the accurate solutions. Manual workforce that will be utilized in some more priority or more intelligent task, maybe, you know, to in how to increase that particular business. So they will be utilized in brainstorming for that, as what we BAs are doing here, simplifying the overall architecture and behavior of the system. Okay, so anything, I mean, Amarnath, you want to add on to this, or any other point if you have?
Yeah, actually, to meet the demand and supply of the product, the automation is a good example. See, earlier we used to have the manual workers, there may be this for supply, the demand will be very less. Now, with an automation and manufacturing industry, especially, we can compensate that demand and supply. Earlier, when I was working in before 2000s, the stock trading was around the paper trading. The what are the losses or profit, the auto credit takes 1 week. Nowadays, it's happened within a day. That I can give a good example, being a stock company where I worked earlier.
Okay, that's great. I mean, yes, I mean, because you can just produce the things in bulk while you're automating that. Yes, Amarna, thanks for that input. Anything, Aparna, Narjis? I'm still not getting the caller too. I mean, I'm not sure if this is Girja or anyone from you, I mean, knowing who can be this person? Any idea?
No.
Okay. Just a second. Okay. So let's proceed. Now, once we have learned like the benefits of automation in the business, so now I will tell you that how IT is actually helping out the business, IT industries, in automating their things. So you have the first thing in IT which you can think of as internet, right? So, I mean, it really starts from here. The automation for any particular franchisee, I mean, nowadays, not only the big organization, even the small firms, you know, they start with, they I have seen a lot of people or a lot of, you know, owners, they're starting their business online first. They're starting their business by creating some FB page for that. Okay. So what is all that? That is all IT. Okay. So even, you know, the startups or, and it is not necessarily that, you know, it is not necessary that only an IT person or, you know, someone related to the computer's background, they are going into this particular field. But yes, if it's a bakery, they are, you know, just launching their FB page and they are just starting getting the revenues out of there, right? So IT is not only used for selling the goods, it is also being used for advertising, for promotions, for all those things, right? So basic core thing from IT which is actually helping out people to generate the revenues, to increase, to enhance their business knowledge also. I mean, you know, if as a homemaker, I am just starting off with something related to food or technologies, I have so much of, you know, things to learn about from internet, I mean, that is from IT. Okay. So IT is actually serving out a lot many people, a railway booking system, a train booking system, you know, think of Amazon. I mean, what's that? They are completely, I should say, they do not own anything, basically. They do not own any kind of home products. They do not manufacture any particular kind of products, but still, today, I mean, they are the pioneer of selling the goods, not only in one domain, but across globe, across domains. They are not the manufacturers. They have no plans for them. I mean, they have no factories. They have no plans. They have nothing to manufacture. They are just the agents. So just with the help of that e-commerce platform, what have they done till date? Just because of that IT, see how where they are now. So, I mean, you know, IT has really helped so many organizations, even not only Amazon, I mean, the products, the goods which they are selling from different, you know, domains or different, like they are selling books, okay? But it's not, you know, in their bucket to have the knowledge of how the books have been manufactured, how the things have been done. They are just the agents between a particular franchisee, between a particular brand to the customers. So they are. So the brand is also benefited, that franchisee is also benefited. Also, it is the Amazon which is generating a big revenue, actually, which is actually making a big money nowadays. Google is again IT. So you name it and, you know, it's IT everywhere, I should say. I mean, you are associated even Narji said that she was also in HR. So for HR also, to get all the reports of the employees of the company, you know, just even letting, just getting the idea of punching in, punching out of the employees, everything is automated. I mean, Narji need not go to all the employees to actually, you know, look at or not maintaining any registers to actually mark the attendance of the employees. Everything is automated. So gone the time, I mean, where, you know, you have all those paperworks, manual works, all the errors, but now it's the era of IT. Specifically, to be very, very specific, it's the internet, I mean, which has actually taken over almost everything. So in IT, we talk of internet. Now, yes, that is one thing. We talk of networks, we talk of, I will just explain you like what all servers are, what is databases. So we'll be covering that, you know, I'll just give you a brief of all these terminologies in terms of IT. I know you all might be knowing the literal meaning of databases, but in terms of IT, how we can relate a database. So we'll be covering all those things in, later sessions. A hardware, a software, a computer, the applications, you know, the security systems. So everything is just clubbed into one particular thing, that is the information technology. So there's Dennis who have joined us. Hi, Dennis. Dennis, I'm audible. Not sure. Okay. So now, before we move on to the IT sector, let's have a brief idea about the classification of the IT industries. So across globe, if you will see that, you know, all the IT industries, they are actually segregated in two classes. One is a product-based IT company. The other is a service-based IT company. So anything what comes up in your mind, with the name product-based, Aparna, anything, I mean, what you can think of in a product-based IT company? What should be product for an IT?
Yeah. So I think it's like a website developing.
Yeah, that is one product. Correct. You are absolutely correct. So a company, website, I'll just, just refine it, refine the term website for a company. Website is a kind of promotional thing for a company. But yes, if they are a manufacturers of certain kind of products and they are just selling out that products through the website, or to be very specific, if they are integrating it with that e-commerce platform, so that is a product for that company. Which product is something which will give you revenue, right? Anything.
Yeah, like Microsoft, Microsoft Office, the product. Yeah.
Yes, that's the biggest example of Microsoft, which, so you have all the products, Office, you use Excel, you use Visual, you use everything. I mean, even the presentations is also from the, even the Windows, the operating system you're working on. So that is all provided by the Microsoft. Yes, Aparna, that's a brilliant example. So thank you.
Welcome.
Yeah. So this is like a product based ID company. So that is like, which all the company which actually creates some kind of system or generates some kind of system which the customers or the end users will be using, and so that the particular company is generating or they are getting their profits or revenues. Okay. So Microsoft is one best example of a product-based company. You can think of Adobe. You have, because all the companies who are manufacturing the softwares, who are creating the software, so all the softwares are the product for an IT. Okay, so all the softwares you are using, software is nothing again, but software is something which is actually running on your system, any application which is running on your system. Nowadays, the people who are having Android phone, they have that Play Store. So you have so many of applications, so many of games over there. So all those things like the applications, the games, what are they? I mean, they all are the softwares, they all are the products from the IT industries. Okay, so they have been manufactured as a product from an IT company, because as soon as you download those, so definitely a portion of share, so that is actually shared with that particular company who has generated that particular product or that particular application. You know Uber nowadays, you have so many companies. Amazon is a product-based company. They are not manufacturing goods, but yes, as an e-commerce platform, that particular e-commerce site, that is a product for themselves. Okay, so a company which is actually creating the softwares for themselves, they are the product-based company. Okay, so now how a product-based company is what? I mean, process-wise, like how a product-based company is actually working. So the first thing they will be doing is to conceptualize a particular product, all right? If I want to develop a certain application for a Play Store, so first I have to actually conceptualize, like, what exactly do I need to create? Okay, like for example, if I need to create a booking system or a reservation system, or a game. Okay, so first of all, I need to actually do all kind of market survey, all kind of validation of the concept. Like if I will be creating some kind of, like, say, doctor appointment booking system, if I want to create for a certain city or, for a country, okay? So first of all, I need to do a market survey, that are there people who will be actually using that particular product? What is the percentage of the people who will be actually using? Because, a doctor is visited not only by the urban class, they are also visited by the rural classes. So how acquainted or how familiar they are with that particular thing, with usage of the Android phones or usage of the appointments. So probably, you have to do all kind of research before you actually start up with the software, with the, with the creation of the product based for the IT. Okay. So that's the market survey you have to do. You have to validate, like now in a current scenario, you have to check like whether there are certain other systems who are actually, who have actually developed that particular application which you are thinking of. If yes, then, what are the shortcomings and how you will be actually upgrading those applications, or you will be providing the add-on benefits, as compared to that particular application. So all those things needs to be very well validated before even you start up with the product. You have to do a kind of feasibility study. You have to actually analyze that, for creating that particular software, do you really have that manpower? Okay. The time estimation should be there, product startup, then development, and then the completion of the product. If it's a certain kind of, if you are a manufacturer of a mobile phones, then definitely it should be packaging and marketing also. Packaging would be one thing. If you are developing a certain hardware, so the packaging will also be involved. If it is a software, then definitely it's just the marketing you have to look at. Sales and after sales support. So warranty support and everything will be lying under that. So anything, any questions or anything which you guys need to understand for related to the product based IT companies? So I assume that, we are very much clear with the concept of a product based IT company. Okay, so now next is your service based IT company. So anything Amarnath, that comes up in your mind as a service based IT company?
Again, give the best example of Deloitte and as well as Microsoft itself. They sell the products and they give services for them.
What kind of services do you think that Microsoft is providing?
See, any kind of, suppose if there are any company using SQL thing, they can use a SQL I don't have any idea, just I'm guessing it. How about that? Deloitte is an implementation partner for a lot of things, and we can take the examples of SAP and Salesforce. They used to sell their products and they used to give the services for them.
Yes, up to a certain extent, Amarnath, but I was I will refine on to that. I mean, there is a difference. One is like support and one is a service. So if I am delivering a certain product, I mean, like being a Microsoft, what are you saying?
Banking and finance is a service-based company, right, for the clients.
Yes, banking and finance is a service-based company, definitely. But in terms of IT, I was actually thinking of the service-based industries. Yes.
Is Google a service-based company?
Which one?
Google.
No. Google. Google has their own products. So.
Okay.
Let me just.
Which of the company which develops the IT application? I can take the example of Infosys.
Yes. That's absolutely correct. So Infy is a service-based company. So there is a kind of, small difference between a support and a service. So one thing, a Google, what it is doing is currently is like they are actually creating the, they have their search engine, Google search engine. They have their mailing accounts. They have YouTube channels. So those are all the products. So now those products, they are consumed by the customers. They are being used by the customers. Okay. So now, because see, if I'm even, not only in IT, if you talk about any other product-based company, which actually, suppose a company who is manufacturing refrigerators, okay? So now once I have bought Whirlpool or anything, once I have purchased any kind of goods or products from them, definitely a kind of service or support. I mean, I should not use that term interchangeably. I will call it as support. Okay, so that is their responsibility to provide a kind of support for that particular product which I have already bought from them. Right, so that is the support which a product based company is providing. Microsoft, they are providing the support on whatever products they are being, you know, delivering so far. So that those are the product based company. But yes, as you said, Amarnath, Infosys, it doesn't manufacture or it doesn't create any product of its own in terms of IT. They do not create softwares. They just provide the services to other vendors. They create applications for, you know, different franchisees, for different like, for example, I'm just starting up with a business, or let's take an example of a cruise line industry, like let's say a Carnival Cruise Lines. Okay, so now Carnival Cruise Line, they have their particular process, the complete process of checking in and checking out. They have the drills which are happening onto their ships. Okay, so now if they want to automate those particular things, so now either what they can do is they can just create their own IT department and they can, you know, just start doing the automation within the company itself, or they can just hire some vendors, like either it can be Infosys, either it can be TCS, it can be, you know, any other company you can think of. So all those service based companies, they can hire certain companies which will be actually creating those softwares, creating those sites for them, right? So this is how the service based company are working. So they every service based company, they will be having certain clients. So those clients will be giving them certain sufficient amount of work. And then the business analyst in the service-based company, they will be just taking out the work from the clients. They will be understanding the requirements of the clients. At times, you know, the BA is also recommended to or posted to the client location to understand their processes and then creating a particular software for them to automate their business, basically. Okay. So this is how we classify the product-based and the service-based companies. Google doesn't provide any services to any kind of, you know, vendors. They do not create softwares for any other vendors. They create the softwares for their own. Facebook is a product-based company. Twitter is a product-based company. They have their own product which they're working on. Uber is a product-based company. So they have their own, car booking system, cab booking system. But the, you know, as we say that Infosys or you can say Ernst & Young, and Infosys is there, TCS is there, and Wipro is there. So all those companies, they are service-based companies. They do not manufacture anything. They do not create any software. They are just the vendors for other companies. Deloitte is again a service-based company. Okay. So there is a certain difference in the working culture of a product-based and a service-based. So in product-based, as you see that, you know, product conceptualization is done within the company and for the company itself. But in service-based, it's more of the, you know, like, let's say I've started a service-based company. I have to, first thing is to advertise. And the product-based, first thing is to actually think of a product, conceptualize a product, then do the survey. And marketing comes completely at the end. I mean, once the product is developed. But in the service-based company, first of all, you have to sell yourself. I mean, sell yourself as a company that, okay, I am a product-based company. I am creating certain things. I have certain kinds of manpower. I have certain kind of technologies with me. I have certain kind of resources and, you know, the strength with me. So now tell me what you want to develop. Okay. So the first thing which comes into picture for a service-based company is to actually pitch in into the market to get the clients, to get the, you know, get the work basically for them. So first thing that comes into picture for a service-based company is the marketing thing. It can be through anything. I mean, through emails, through calls, through advertising, anything. Then the second thing comes as the client acquisition. Okay, so you have to acquire your client. So there are, again, certain methods which, and there is a specific sales team associated with all the service-based company who are responsible for getting the clients. So all those, you know, kind of bidding and everything happens once, you know, to get the projects, basically. Okay, so client acquisition is one thing which the sales team will be doing in a service-based company. And then there comes the requirement gathering and analysis. So requirement gathering and analysis is one thing which a service-based company will be doing for the clients. Okay. And after that, there comes once the completely, I mean, the complete requirement is understood. So let's say, I mean, this is the foremost part from the BA perspective, the requirement gathering and analysis. So in a service-based company, the BA's role is important from the second point onwards. I mean, sometimes, BA, even, you know, if it's a very small firm and they do not have a dedicated, okay, just give me a second. Let me just connect the charger here. Just give me a minute.
Hello.
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 Yeah, am I audible now?
Yes.
Okay. Fine. Thank you. So now we have actually learned about the product based and service based company. So now let's move on to the projects. Like, you know, in any company, be it be a service based or a product based, you will always come across a term name as projects. So projects, I mean, it is not just for the IT. It's project is everywhere. I mean, every all the architects, they are having a certain projects on which they are working. Doctors have certain projects, you know, every person who is working, they have a certain goal, a certain set of objectives they need to achieve, and they have a certain roadmap to achieve that. Okay, so I'll call it as a term. I mean, the term which is used is called as a project worldwide. Okay, so anything, I mean, you guys understand with the term project, or you can associate the term project in IT, basically. So as you know, now you guys have a brief understanding of what an IT industry does. Okay, so what exactly can you think of a project in terms of IT?
Can I give an example?
Yeah, sure.
So sometimes we get these updates on our phone and stuff. So it's kind of like again a project for the, suppose if it's an iPhone and there's a software update. So that software update was created as a project by the IT company. So that can be a project.
Yes, I mean, that was a project for that company. Yes, definitely. Correct, Narjis. Yes, I mean, that is absolutely right. So project is anything which, again, a company is working on with a definite set of processes, which includes a definite set of processes. So a project, what is it? It is just a temporary endeavor which is undertaken to create a unique product, service, or result. Having said that, as I've literally mentioned, that it's a temporary endeavor. So that means every project which starts, it needs to end. Okay. None of the project in the entire world is ongoing. They will certainly be having a definite end time or the closure time wherein the specific product, if it is in terms of IT, let's say if we are designing a website, so the website itself is a project, okay? So it should have a certain starting point, it should have a certain ending point or the closure, okay? By closure, it means that, you know, if that particular project, it accumulates or it has all these features or it facilitates all those functionalities. So once that all has been done, the project is closed. Okay. So every project, it will have a definite beginning. It will have a defined ending. Okay. So now, this is a kind of project life cycle at a very high level. I mean, I shouldn't say that it's the exact life cycle which has been followed, but that is at a very high level. That firstly, what happens is every project is initiated. Either it is by the company itself, if it is a product based company, or you have taken a work from some particular client, if you are a service based company, or you are acting as a vendor for a particular client. So a project is initiated. It is planned, it is designed, then it is developed. Okay. Once it is developed, it is again, you know, kind of monitored, it is tested, you know, so a support team is also there. If they found certain kind of errors or bugs or anything, then again that goes into the design phase or the planning phase to rectify, to correct all the errors. And then, you know, once those plan is in place for refining all the you know, all the shortcomings of the project, so again that execution is done and the cycle keeps on continuing until unless all the errors have been resolved, the system is working as expected, and finally then the closure is there or the sign off is there from whosoever the stakeholder will be. So this is how a project life cycle actually works. Any question? Or, you know, you can just pitch in if you are not understanding a particular terminology or, you know, a certain kind of nomenclature which I am using. Because sometimes, you know, being into IT from many years, it happens that, you know, that comes some certain nomenclatures that are so obvious for me, but sometimes it is not that easier for you to grasp. So you can definitely pitch me in, I mean, anytime if you cannot get certain points or certain things. Okay, cool. So now, as we already started, I mean, there are two types of industries. One is product based, the other is service based, right? Similarly, there are two kind of projects which are running. Okay, and these two type of projects, they are generally, I mean, you know, those concepts have generally arose from the service based industries, but sometimes the product based or companies also, you know, kind of work on this kind of project. And these two classification, it is simply based on the payment method, I mean, for the project. How that particular project is being paid for. I mean, if it's a product-based company, then how the budget is basically sanctioned for that project. So sanctioning of budget actually classifies the project in IT. So whenever you will be moving on to IT, you will be always hearing the first thing as a BA, you know, you will be always hearing that it's a fixed bid project or it's a billing project, or for billing project, we call it as T&M, time and money. Okay. So T&M is a common, I should say, the nomenclature which has been followed nowadays. So either a project can be a fixed bid or it can be time and money. Okay. So what exactly, Aparna, you think of if I say a fixed bid project? Anything, I mean, anything you that comes up in your mind as a fixed bid?
What I'm thinking is in a fixed bid, there's a certain amount of money that's assigned to the project and you cannot make changes for that.
Yes, I mean, that is the fixed bid. So the bid is totally fixed for the project. So mm-hmm. Now if as a client, I'm giving a particular vendor to develop a website for me, a promotional website, mm-hmm. you know, to be very specific, I'll just, you know, tell him that, okay, I'll be giving you $1,000 for building that particular website for me. So now that $1,000, it completely lies with the vendor. And irrespective of how many employees, how many resources he is actually putting up into that project. So that is completely the vendor's call. Okay. The client is not bothered about how many systems, how many resources, how many things he has been putting upon. He is just bothered about, okay, I'm giving you this much amount. I want this particular features and functionalities within this particular time frame. Okay. So that time is generally fixed in both the projects, be it be a T&M or the fixed bid. But in fixed bid, it is more rigid. Okay. So the time thing is more rigid and fixed with that, you know, being a client, I am giving you certain amount that, okay, in a month, I need my website. I'll just brief you about all the requirements, not even brief you about, I will detail you all the requirements, all the functionalities which I need in my website. Now take the $1,000 or, you know, certain advance amount, like say $200, take this up, build the website for me. Once I will validate it, and I'll pay you the rest of the amount. So this is how the deal is done in a fixed bid project. Then comes the T&M mode, that is the time and money. So Amarnath, anything, I mean, from the time and money, how it can be different?
Like, can we take the example of Apple product? Every time they release a version 1, version 1.1, version 1.2, depending on the time of the project.
Okay. But in that case, it is quite possible that for a particular version, you know, that budget is fixed.
If you talk any service, suppose any banking or finance, I'm taking that example. But Infosys, they'll have the product called Skinacle. They used to do the supply for the ICICI and every kind of even ADP.
Right.
They used to do that. They keep on servicing the requesters on customer services kind of thing.
But in that case also, Amarnath, because now if Pinnacle, they have already sold out, or they have, you know, I understand that they will be providing services to them. So that is a kind of support services they are providing. And banking person, like for example, if it's an ICICI bank, definitely for that support thing, they are kind of providing the budget or providing the money to Infosys based on the hours which they are providing the support for, if it's a live support.
Okay.
Yeah. So yes, definitely that is a good example of T&M. Like the time the Infosys resources are putting in to provide the support, and ICICI is paying according to that time which Infosys is actually putting up to provide that support. Definitely it's an example of T&M. So T&M is something like, you know, in fixed bid, what happens is like a particular company, it will give the entire amount, and in T&M it is based on number of resources, number of time. So they will be paying on the hourly basis as the project is either progressing or, you know, in case of support, as you said, Amarnath. So in both the cases, the T&M works well. Because for the support, I cannot give, you know, kind of a fixed amount to a company. Okay, like I'm providing you $5,000 and give me support forever. No, it is like, it is generally like, you know, if it is an 8-hour support for today, you will be paid for 8 hours. If you are putting up 2 resources for 8 hours, you will be paid for 16 hours. If you are putting up 5 resources, you will be paid for 40 hours. So it is like that. So based on the time, based on the hours or the, you know, they are putting in the particular company, they are putting in the efforts. So based on that, the payment is done by the client. So this is how the T&M companies are working. So generally, you know, if you go nowadays, mostly the support projects, some support projects are still, you know, in the fixed bid thing, but generally the support projects are on the T&M mode if it's a live support. Okay. But in, because it all depends on the tickets also in the live support. If suppose, you know, it's kind of, there are 10 tickets a day and, you know, there are 3 resources that are, you know, pitched in for that particular day. So that particular company will be paying for 3 into 8, that is 24 hours for that particular day. But on the next day, if there are just 1 ticket and only 1 resource is working, they will be paying only for the 8 hours. Okay, so it is based on like, you know, you generally in the IT companies, you have a timesheet thing. So generally a client, you know, they request or they ask the particular vendor or the resources of the particular vendor to fill in their timesheets, like how many hours the resources are working on a particular day. Based on that, the payment will be done from the client. So that is done, how it is done in T&M. But mostly if you move on to the IT industry, nowadays mostly have been switched on to the fixed bid. Because the fixed bid, you know, it has advantages in its own terms for the client also. because you know that of the frequency of intervention, I mean, from the client end, it is really reduced. Okay. And now, because you know the clients are also somewhat technical, so they also kind of have an understanding that okay, this particular piece of code or this particular feature that can be developed in certain time in a certain amount. Okay, so based on that, the fixed bid is currently, you know, in trend for the companies. Gone the time, I mean, where you know that the T&M mode was there and the companies and the clients were actually asking the resources and they were actually, you know, keeping an eye on the resources who are working. So nowadays, you know, no client is actually, I mean, there are very few clients who are so much bothered, or they are, you know, kind of in that mode that I need to just track all the things and based on that, I'll be providing you the money. It's the fixed bid project. So it is good for client also because they are not overburdened with all the tracking thing, and the company, the vendors, they are also, you know, working in a kind of freedom. I mean, they got the money, now it is, you know, completely in their hand that how they want to actually deliver the code. So it is just about the quality and the results which matters, not the, I mean, process, how they are actually doing it. So this is the basic difference between the fixed bid and the billing projects. So any questions on this, I mean, before we move on to the next section? Anything? Or even, you know, you can just note down a few points and we can have, or because this PPT and the video will also be shared with you guys, so you can just go through them again. And probably if you have certain queries or certain set of questions, we can take that up in the next sessions also. Okay. Then comes the pre-project activity. Okay, so before we start on to the project, how the project is developed in the IT firm, so what all are the pre-project activities to be done, or which are actually, which a certain, again, it's a kind of processes which the companies, the vendors, the clients, they are following before even, because how will you get the project as a company? You have, okay, you have advertised your business, you have, because, you know, if I want to develop something, if I own a certain kind of business and I want to develop a certain piece of feature, a certain project for my company, so I have different vendors throughout. I mean, I have Infosys, I know HCL, I know TCS, I know Wipro. So, you know, first thing is like, why I will choose Infosys over Wipro, right? So there should be certain things, because if you advertise your business as, you know, as you are an IT company and you are a service-based company, but there are many other service-based companies who are actually existing and, you know, are the pioneer. So why any client will give you their project? Okay. So how those all things are happening, that is not, you know, much of importance from a BA perspective, because generally that is taken care by the sales team. But sometimes in a very small firms or small organization, you know, a pre-sales team is also there. Sometimes, you know, a BA intervention is also required in that pre-sales team, with, you know, some kind of interaction with the pre-sales team. Because BAs are supposed to actually analyze and, you know, do certain kind of research on what the client is actually expecting. Okay, so you can, a BA is the right person who can actually bridge that particular gap between the client expectation and, you know, and his company and his service-based company, that okay, if a client is asking for a website, so a BA is the right person who will be knowing like what all expertise they have, you know, to build that particular website and whether that fits in with the client requirements. Okay, so that is easier to place a bid for the pre-sales team. So it's the pre-project activity, wherein first thing is like a client, they realizes that, you know, a software is needed for a particular app, feature. So the client himself will do an initial analysis on the required feature of the software application. And it will also provide some kind of requirement document to multiple vendors. Okay, so this is what we want. Okay, now here also there is a catch that it's not only, you know, the service-based company who will be having a BA to get the requirements from the client. Definitely a BA is also posted at some for the client also. I mean, for the client company, this particular work is also done by the BA of the client. So client-side BA, they will analyze the requirement, the need of, you know, something which needs to be automated in their business, okay? And then they will be preparing some kind of very high level of the requirements. Okay, this is what needs to be done. And then, you know, it is sent across the vendors, or that has been, it gets published onto certain websites. You know, certain days, nowadays you have those e-lancing, freelancing portals also. So many clients do post their requirements there, and, you know, people place on bid. You know, people place keep placing the bid over that particular requirement. And then whosoever wins that particular bidding, they get the project. Okay. So this is three things which generally any IT company, any service-based IT company will be working upon before the project is started. First of all, an RFP is there, which is kind of a request for proposal. Okay, so that is completely done from the client end. Okay, so they will just prepare a very high level of what is what exactly the business needs. Okay, so that is a request for proposal. I mean, so that the vendors can, you know, send their proposals to them. And then once the proposal has been sent through different vendors, like there are 10 vendors who have sent a proposal for a certain set of RFP, then the client, they will send a request for quotation. Not necessarily to all the 10 vendors. Maybe, you know, they can just pick up 4 or 5 vendors from whom, you know, whose proposals they are interested in. So they can send a request for quotation to them. That is like, you know, the basically the budget and the time and efforts, like how much they will be needing for completion of that particular piece of code or particular project. Once that request for quotation is sent from the client to the suppliers or to the vendors, then, you know, there is a bidding process also. Okay, so like say the bidding process is something like, you know, it's at one place the client is there, and then you have certain vendors, like 5 vendors for which to whom the client has actually sent that RFQ document. All the 5 vendors, they will be placing their bids against the features, against the project. So that is completely done by the pre-sales team or the sales team of the company. So they are good in doing that. I mean, the marketing company basically. So they will be placing all the bids and all those stuff. And once that project is completely sanctioned, okay, to a particular vendor, then comes the scope of work or the statement of work. So this SOW is generally prepared by the BAs. So that is after the project has been sanctioned to your company, it's the BA's responsibility from the company perspective to give a detail of, like, you know, what all needs, what all you will be delivering in what timelines. So it's a complete roadmap which a BA will be providing before the start of the project. It may deviate in between, but not much. I mean, because some kind of, because obviously everything is not completely seen. You know, you cannot foresee everything at the very start of the project. So certain changes are still acceptable, but it should be at a, you know, it should give a complete, a high level of roadmap to the client that how the project will be progressing, while, you know, what all features you will be delivering in what timelines, how many resources you will be putting in. So all those things, I mean, just a brief idea of the complete project life cycle. So that statement of work will be sent by the BA to the client. So any questions on this? Because I know that is a kind of new thing for all of you. I think we all got it. That's great. So, okay, so let me ask Aparna.
Yeah.
Okay. So, let's say like there is a client who have sent a proposal, let's say to build, again, you know, a e-commerce site for them because they own certain kind of goods and they want to sell it. Okay, so now let's say, you know, the RFP document they have sent across, either they have published onto some kind of websites or they have, you know, advertised it somewhere, from where the sales team of a company has picked that project. Okay, so now the sales team is actually working on the proposal. So what do you really think that that particular proposal should actually contain, you know, once you have that proposal in your hand? Because definitely, you know, in certain industries, a BA has to intervene for that proposal thing, right? Because again, the sales team, you know, they are good in marketing, but they are not good in defining a particular thing like a proposal for an e-commerce platform. Okay, being a BA, you are more acquainted or you are more familiar with the technical team. And also, I mean, it's not just the BA, it's the project managers also, which we'll be covering in the next slides. Okay, so it's a role of a project manager along with the BA to provide a proposal kind of thing or to draft a proposal for a certain request. So what really do you think that, you know, be necessary in the in that proposal document? Anything? Anything.
I really didn't get exactly, so yeah.
Okay, no problem. Narjeet,
can you please redefine the question?
Okay, I'm asking, like, say, if as a client, I'm asking you to develop some e-commerce website for me because I own certain kind of goods and I want to sell them through online portal. I want to create that online portal for me. Now, you know, as a vendor, you got the request that there is certain client who is looking for, you know, for the industry who can prepare that kind of online portal for them. You got that request. Now you want to send me a proposal to actually, you know.
Okay.
Yeah. So what do you think that, you know, you want, you should include in that proposal? So that, you know, it is appealing for me that, you know, I should get back to you that, okay, I mean, the client is interested in you.
It would, what I think would include is the previous projects and the accomplishments that have been handled.
Definitely.
By this company.
Yeah, definitely.
The so, timeline, yeah, and the timeline and the deliverables in the timeline that have been met.
Yes, I mean, timelines at a very high level. Deliverables you need not mention in the proposal because client is not really interested in getting that. Because, you know, when the request for proposal is done, generally by that time, the client is also not very clear about like what exactly he just have an idea. Okay, so he knows that, okay, I need to build an online portal, but maybe, you know, at certain point of time or sometimes what happens is they are not very sure about the criticality, the entire thing. They're just looking for the vendors to who can build that, and the BA from the vendor's end, they also help those clients to actually, you know, detail those set of requirements to because sometimes that details are not there with the client at the time of the proposal that is made. Okay, So,
okay, so maybe the strengths of the vendor in like what they are, the skills and the strengths of the vendor which meet the requirements of the client.
Yes, Aparna. So that is absolutely correct. I mean, this is the only thing which is to be mentioned in the proposals. So in the proposal document, you mention about your company, you mention about your previous projects, you mention about your experiences, like, and just in a manner that it gets fit into the requirement or the proposal which the client have asked for. Like, for example, if they have been asked for an online portal, so probably you may define that, you know, you have already been building some e-commerce platform using these many technologies, and, you know, you have certain skill sets, you have that much of experienced people with you. So all those things should be there in the proposal document so that it is like kind of appealing for the client. Absolutely correct, Aparna. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yeah, Narjeet, you want to say something?
Sorry.
Okay, I guess it's okay.
I'm sorry. I actually joined this meeting. I wasn't aware of this, so I was not really prepared. So my kids are like running around. So I'm trying to say something and they start crying in the background. So sorry.
Okay,
but my question. Actually, I wanted to ask you a question. So the RFP. So it's a document which the business need appears, right?
Yes.
So it doesn't really like tell you or lay down like what you actually need in your documents. Like you want a website, you want a login, you want a user ID, password, and all that detailed stuff.
No, it's not that. So that's a completely different thing. That's a BRD which will be coming once the project is completely sanctioned. It will just have a need that, okay, I want to create an online portal or I want to create a website, maybe feature all the basic information, and it should have a kind of small detailing of like what we are doing and a promotional, some kind of promotions or some kind of, you know, that kind of thing. So just a very brief, not like what pages you need, what exactly the content there. So that is not the part of RFP.
So this is pretty much the first step.
Yes, it is the first step. It is the first step, Anand, for any business.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. So now. So this is, you know, how you will be working in an IT industry. So this is the complete project structure of the IT business. And this is like common throughout the IT industry, be it be a service-based or a product-based. Okay. So now you can see that, you know, you can see a horizontal blue line here, which is segregating something. The team here and the team above. Okay, so the team above is the business team, the functional team, I should say. The team below is the technical team. Okay, so the team above contains all the stakeholders. They contains all the subject matter experts. They contains, sometime it contains the technology head also. Okay, so that means like, you know, let's say, if I'm a cruise line industry and I want to build or automate the drilling system, I mean, they have some kind of mock drills on the cruise line industries or any department. I mean, you have been working so far. They have fire drills. They have so many of mock drills, you know. So similarly, in case of cruise line industry, they have that mock drills. Okay. So wherein they are actually educating all the onboarded souls that, you know, how to evacuate and how to gather in case of emergency situations. So in that case, you know, now let's say they want to automate that process up to a certain extent. Like, initially what they were doing in the mock drilling was that, you know, they have certain assembly points onto the cruise itself. Okay. So at a case of emergency, in the case of emergency, what happens is, like, you know, everyone has seen Titanic, because I'm taking this example so that, you know, you can just relate. So in that case, when once the Titanic was actually drowning, so in that case, what happened? Because you have certain decks, you know, in that ship, okay, certain floors. So you cannot expect the person who is at the lowermost floor in the emergency situation to gather at, you know, at the 11th floor or the 9th floor or, you know, the floor which is at the top. So there should be some kind of assembly point for the lower people at the lower floor itself, right? So there should be some kind of authority that is assigned at the lower floor, which is actually, you know, collecting the names that who all have been gathered. So had that been done manually, think like how much time it would have consumed, okay? And you will have no idea that, you know, how many peoples are already left inside the rooms. So now a cruise line industry, they come and say that we need to automate, like we need to provide a kind of tablets or kind of phones to all the authorities which are there on the assembly points, so that, you know, they can just gather, or they can just click on like who all have been gathered, so that they can have a kind of remote report immediately that who all have been left. Okay. So, you know, that kind of automation they want to do. Okay. So now, for this particular project, like who all are the business stakeholders? Stakeholders are the ones who are actually using the current manual system, because you will get the requirements from them. Okay. So those, they are the functional authorities who are actually working currently and gathering all the people manually. Okay. So now all the authorities who have been gathering at the assembly point, the captain, the, you know, the persons who are actually putting up all those persons onto the boats. So all those people are the stakeholder of that drill system. Okay. So those, that is the functional team which is actually using that thing. You are developing an e-commerce website for a company, and you know, the stakeholders would be the people who are actually, you know, the managers, or, you know, who are there in the departments wherein the products are getting manufactured, so that they have the complete knowledge of the product which is getting created. Okay. So those are the stakeholders. So those are the functional members from where you can get the requirements which you need to automate. The people who will give you the idea of the process, they will give you the idea of the product, they will give you the idea of, you know, the entire functions which needs to be automated. So those are the business stakeholders. Then comes the subject matter experts. Subject matter experts, SMEs, can be anyone. I mean, they can be from, you know, the IT, they can be the IT people also. If a client is already having an IT team, so probably they might be the IT team also, who will look into that functional, who will just coordinate with the functional team to understand whether that thing, you know, that can be automated or not. You know, the feasibility study, or, you know, what all technologies should they put in to actually get the optimum solution. Okay. So those are all the subject matter experts. Then comes the technology head. Technology head is a person who is actually interacting with the complete technical team below. So who is actually responsible for the delivery of the project, for getting the project and then delivering it to the stakeholders. Okay. So this technology head, he has that complete team under him, the team which contains the technical architect, the project manager, the testing team, and the support team. Okay. So sometimes the technical architects and the project manager, that these two teams, you know, that acts as a single team in an IT. Okay. So now I'll just differentiate like how the project manager team and what is the difference between a technical architect team. So technical architects are the ones in IT industry who are, you know, who are very experienced people in terms of a specific technology. Like, say, if I want to develop a particular online portal, and you know, there are various technologies. I'll just name them as of now. Like, for example, there is Java, there is .NET, there is PHP, which is available worldwide to develop the online portal. Okay, so now the technical architect is a person who is having a complete knowledge of all the three technologies and who can just compare between the three technologies, like based on your requirement, which particular technology will fit in that. Okay, so that is why I'm saying sometimes this technical team is a merged, is a group of project manager team and the technical architect team. Okay, so as of now, you know, we will think of a single team, you know, it's not two separate teams. One is the technical team, which contains all the project managers, the developers who will be actually doing the coding and all, you know, who will be actually developing the code for that particular requirement, the leads who will be just managing all the developers, or, you know, they will be just assigning certain amount of work to the developers. They will be reviewing their, you know, their piece of codes. So all those leads are there. So this complete section is the technical team, the development team, I should say, who will be developing the code for the requirement. Here comes the testing team. QA is the quality analyst. That is nothing but the testers. So once the code is developed, you know, that code is given to the testing team. So now the testing team, they are also the technical team. So now this particular technical team will actually evaluate the code which has been developed by the development team. Okay. And the evaluation is done based on the requirements. I mean, what all requirements the stakeholders has provided. So whether that piece of code, you know, that actually fits into that requirement. So, I mean, the testing team, it will not only do the functional testing. I mean, just mapping the code with whatever the requirements are. They will also perform various kind of testing, like, you know, the scalability, the load testing, the performance testing, you know, all kind of regression testing they will be doing. Because, like, say, as in India, we have a site wherein we can book the railway tickets. So at single given point, I mean, imagine how many users can access that particular site to book the ticket. Like, at this particular moment also, there will be lakhs of users who have, you know, that particular site opened on the system and they're booking the system. Okay. So whatever piece of code you have developed, whether that is, you know, kind of, it is ready to accept that much of load, that much of traffic. Okay. So that kind of testing is also needed. Whether that particular piece of code is scalable, because in future, if, you know, the stakeholders, they are asking for adding onto certain features onto that project. Okay, so is that feasible? So all those things needs to be tested by the testing team. And once the testing team is done with the testing, the product is up and running, they have delivered the entire thing to the stakeholders, then comes the support team. So support is also a kind of ongoing support, the live support, or it can be a warranty support also. Like, once the piece of code you have delivered, you can provide, you know, 3 months, 2 months of warranty, wherein the stakeholders or the business team, they will be testing that particular piece of code in the live scenario. Okay, and then in case of any errors, any problems, any issues, they will be just contacting the support team who is responsible for clearing all those errors. Okay, so support team will not work in parallel with these two teams. Support team will come into picture once the project is being delivered completely, and these two teams are basically released from that project. I know it's too much for understand for today, but I'm sure if you will just go through the video once again, you will have a better understanding. Like, you know, once or twice, you can just revise that through the video also. So any doubts here in the IT project structure?
Hi, just a small doubt about the SME subject matter expert? It's from the client side, or maybe not in the client. What knowledge should have that person? Means he should have the technical and as well as the functional, or is only looking to functional?
Okay, so in that case, sometimes you know the subject matter experts are, if they are from the client side, sometimes they are the functional people from where you can like, for example, if it's in, again I said that, you know, probably if it's in e-commerce company, okay, I mean if it's a company wherein they manufacture certain kind of goods, okay, like jewelry manufacturing, I should say. Okay, so in that case, the SME from the client will be a person who is having the complete knowledge of all the, you know, functions, all the processes, all the products, all the jewelries, all the stones which they have been using so far. So SME is a person who has having a complete functional knowledge of the requirement, okay, from the client perspective. But if, you know, if I talk about from the vendor perspective for that particular company, the SME will be a person who is having the complete knowledge of what all technologies are there in the market, you know, and what exactly will be, you know, whether that particular requirement which is sent by the SME of the client side, whether that is feasible to be developed onto certain using certain set of technologies or not. I mean, he doesn't have to be clear about whether that kind of experience lies within the company or not. That is the BA's responsibility. But SME should be aware of the technologies which will actually result, you know, in that particular product, the online portal which the client is asking for. And
Can be called as a product owner?
Yes, he's the product owner. Yes, definitely. From both the end, they are the product owners, basically.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So this is, we will be taking later on. I'll just tell you one thing, so that it is easier with us for the next day. So now no one actually questioned me like where the BA is. So I'll tell you from my side, I mean, because as we are here for the BA course, not for the SME, not for the technical lead or something. So business analyst is somewhat here. He is a liaisoning between the stakeholders and the technology head, because he understands the business need, tries to fit in within that technology which the technology head has actually formalized for, or they have decided for. Okay, because subject matter expert, he has, you know, just checked for the feasibility study that whether, you know, that is feasible or not using a certain set of technology. Then there is a technology head, like for example, an SME has thought of using the .NET for developing that particular thing. So the technology head will be a person who is an experienced person in .NET. Okay. So now the BA will act as a liaison between the functional requirements of the stakeholders and the implementation side of that particular functional requirement into .NET. A BA is not supposed to learn .NET for that, but at least, you know, he should have a kind of brief idea. I mean, he's not required to understand that at a coding level or something, but he should have a brief knowledge about certain things of, you know, that particular technology. And that knowledge eventually he will be grasping once he is into the project, because the project manager is also working along with the business analyst. Okay, so technical person will be the project manager for all the technical queries, and BA will be responsible for all the functional requirements. So a BA will be providing all the requirements from business stakeholders to the technology head or to the project manager. So it all depends, the structure of the company. Sometimes we do not have any technology head, we directly have the project manager. So in that case, the BA will be directly acting as a liaisoning between the business and the project manager, the development team, basically. So here the BA comes into picture. So he's responsible for all the processes that needs to be followed while developing the project. He is responsible for all the communication that needs to be happen with the stakeholders. He is responsible to actually clarify all the doubts from the development team. He is responsible for actually, you know, creating and developing and, you know, all the documentations for the project. Okay, and ultimately, I mean, he's also responsible for the functional level testing once the product is developed. Okay, so that, you know, he is sure of that whatever the requirements were, the code which has been developed that fits into that requirement. So everything is, you know, lies within the BA. Okay, so tomorrow, that is it for today. I mean, tomorrow we will be understanding more on what exactly the business analysis is, what a BA is supposed to do, what are the roles and responsibility of the business analyst. So all those things will be taking up in the next session. Meanwhile, I'll request you all to actually go through with this video. I'll ask Michael to share all the links. I'll upload the video onto their portal. So just go through with the video of today's session, the PPTs, and, you know, we can just take up all the queries in the next session now. And if you have anything to discuss now, please let me know.
No, I'm good. Thank you.
Thanks, Amarnath.
Mika, so when is the next session? Is it tomorrow?
No, it will be on your Monday evening. Yeah, what's I mean, today is Friday evening at your end, right?
Thursday evening,
right? So it will be on Monday evening.
Okay. Thank you so much, Mika.
Yeah, and Michael will also be coordinating with you guys, I mean, for the next session and all the details on that.
Okay, sure. Yeah,
okay. Thanks a lot, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, bye.
Right.